My Charlemagne, my Charlemagne, my Charlemagne, my Charlemagne, don't go.
Saying it was your fault, although you could have done more. Oh, you're so naive, yes, yeah, so how could this be done with such a smiling sweetheart? Oh, and your sweet and pretty face is such a lovely way for something so beautiful. Oh, that every time I look inside, I know. She knows that I'm not fond of asking. True or false it may be, or she's still out to get me. And I know, she knows that I'm not fond of asking. True or false it may be, she's still out to get me. I may say it was your fault, cause I know you could've.
Pulse Europe 2018 is about to begin. Please take your seats in the Zinc Meeting Hall immediately.
Just don't let me down. Hold on to your kite. Just don't. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Gainsight's General Manager of EMEA, Dan Steinman.
Lightning and the thunder, 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 feel the thunder.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Pulse. So excited to see all of you here. Every time, this is the 10th Pulse I've done. Every single time, I'm amazed when I come out and see so many people. And the other thing that's amazing is every single time, I realize that the Pulse crowd is the best looking crowd of all conferences. So thank you guys for coming. Yeah, thank you. Give yourselves a, those of you who think you're good looking, actually give yourselves some applause. Yeah, it's so great to be here. I've been in London now for 2 years exploring the EMEA customer success wave. It's been really a joy to get to know many of you personally. So welcome. This is Pulse number 4. So we're celebrating our 4th birthday in Europe. Raise your hand if you were at the first Pulse in Europe 3 years. Oh my gosh, that is so awesome. Thank you guys for coming back and back and back and back. We got to keep doing that. We're not going to do happy birthday. I'm not going to ask you guys to sing happy birthday. But this is our 4th birthday as a Pulse Europe event anyway. I have a hard time believing that it's 4. It goes by so fast. It's like raising kids. They're suddenly 4 years old. And only when you look at their one-year-old picture do you realize how big they've gotten. Because you don't see it on a daily basis. But 4 is kind of a challenge because I wanted to do some cheeky things about 4. And I had a hard time figuring out what to say about 4. 3 is easy, like, you know, third time's a charm, and good things come in threes, and things like that. But it was a little bit harder for 4. So excuse me if I don't hit everyone's mark. One of the things I came up with 4, if you're an American baseball fan like I am, someone hits a grand slam, that's worth 4 runs. Do not ask me what the cricket equivalent is. I have absolutely no idea. But that's a big deal in America. That's a big deal in America, anyway. Our friends across the Irish Sea have something with 4 leaves. That's supposed to be a good luck charm, so that's kind of cool. Apparently, there's something called the EU Big 4. How many knew that? Did anybody know that? Is that soon to be the EU Big 3? I don't know. Doesn't seem very exciting to me, but I did find it. There was something that I really liked. If you're a music fan, and especially if you're a British music fan, then you would agree probably that sometimes fabulous things come in fours. So that's pretty cool. One of the things I do love about 4 is that I think when you get to 4, you can legally start using Roman numerals. And that's cool because Roman numerals give you status and gravitas and dignity and all sorts of good things like that. So if you think about the things that have Roman numerals associated with them, American football, some of you might have heard of this thing called the Super Bowl. They always put Roman numerals on that. That's cool. When you do the Olympics, of course, the Olympiads all have Roman numerals associated with them. So I think almost without exception, when you put Roman numerals on something, they have real dignity, real gravitas, real class. Well, almost without exception. No offense to anyone who thought the 4th Rocky was really good. I love Rocky, but number 4 was not so great. So there are exceptions to that. We're going to make sure Pulse isn't one of them. So welcome to Pulse 4. A little bit of fun. Now I'm super excited to move
in. Who's excited? Who's fired up? What are you doing, Dan?
What are you doing here?
What are you doing here, Dan? I'm
keynote.
It's the Friday morning keynote, right? I'm doing the Friday morning keynote now?
Yes, you are, when it becomes Friday, which is tomorrow.
I thought time zones are different here, so isn't this Friday now or no? No? It's still Thursday? Thursday morning keynote. Well, hi, everyone.
Well, it's always good to see you.
Nice to see you, Dan.
Even if you're stealing my thunder and taking over my keynote. Well, while we're here, maybe let's catch up a little bit.
That sounds good. How are you doing?
How are things in California?
California's great, beautiful weather. You know, America's doing awesome. Everyone gets along, no disharmony whatsoever. The whole revolution independence thing is working out great.
I'm speaking for the Brits now. We're very, very proud of you guys.
We're not moving back in the home anytime soon. Yeah, we'll see.
How's the Gainsight world in the US?
Gainsight's going great. Look at this. It's amazing. So honored to have all these people here. Really, really exciting.
Pulse number 10, our 10th one that we've done together.
Yeah, very special.
Every single time you've said who's excited, who's fired up.
That's right.
Sometimes when it was just you on the stage, sometimes when it was...
to my kids sometimes, yeah.
Practicing it all the time. Yeah, well, I was about to do a little session on customer success trends.
That sounds great.
So since you're here, you want to join me?
Let's do it.
Is that okay with everybody?
Is that okay? What's happening in customer success?
It's a customer success vote. Is it okay if Nick joins me for this? Yeah, you guys are okay with that? All right.
Awesome.
We'll do it. Okay, well, let's talk about trends. We've been doing this at Gainsight now for 6 years. I've been in customer success for, feels like all my life, at least 10 years since we've been calling it that. So it's been really fun to see some of the trends. One of the things, Nick and I have talked a lot about this over the last few years, and that is we used to think about customer success as this post-sales thing, right? And it was just that department that took care of customers. But the reality is, it is so abundantly clear that customer success drives sales.
Yeah.
Right, Nick?
Post-sales, I think, as a concept is really dated now, right? Because it's like every single customer that buys from you is talking to other customers before they buy. I don't know if there's any deal that happens without a customer researching it with other folks now, right?
Yeah. So. Yeah, I think I say it this way. Customer success drives sales because your prospects are talking to your customers. Whether you know about it or not, it's that little thing called LinkedIn, right?
Right.
I mean, we did this survey, right? For a year, we surveyed every customer that signed, and what did we find?
It was like 100% of them had talked to other Gainsight customers before buying Gainsight,
yeah.
Right? And it's the logical thing to do.
Yeah. So I hate to tell you that your customer reference program is obsolete, but it might actually be obsolete because your prospects are talking to your customers. And you have to figure out how to measure that. So we use this term advocacy, and we try to measure advocacy because those back channel conversations are so critical.
Oh yeah, and it's amazing because I think a lot of companies now are realizing that customer success definitely drives retention, which is awesome, drives expansion, but the value in advocacy, it's hard to quantify, but that might be the biggest value of all if you're a growing business.
Yep.
So I think people are realizing they need to invest more in advocacy.
Yeah, it's tricky because some of those conversations are going on between users.
Right.
And we don't talk to all of our users. But we have to measure, is their sentiment something that would cause them to say positive things? Because we know they're getting those calls. Like, I see that you're using Gainsight. What do you think about it, right? We know that's happening all the time. So let's talk about this one, Nick. You can talk a bit about this one because this comes largely from you, from the top down, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's interesting because I think this has been a concept, customer success being a company-wide priority, that's been there since the beginning of the industry. I remember, Dan, when you wrote the 10 Laws of Customer Success in 2013, I think.
Long time ago.
Yeah, long time ago. And you said this, right? And I think we were aspiring for this to be true, for companies to really think it was true at the top. We hope CEOs would say this is a top-down company-wide commitment. And I'm just blown away by how much it's happening now.
Yeah.
Like CEOs coming to this conference, Gainsight and other folks getting invited to speak to CEOs, to management teams, to private equity firms, because it's something that I think people realize can't just be solved in a silo.
Yeah, it was an aspirational statement when we wrote it.
Yeah.
But we knew it needed to be true. We wanted it to be true. And I don't know how that happened, but it kind of became true, right?
Yeah, I think the community willed it, but I think also it just had to be, because customer success, as you'll talk about, doesn't scale unless you have the whole company behind you.
Yeah, it used to be people would set up a customer success organization like this, and they would say, you're responsible for customer success, but of course the whole company is behind you until somebody churns, and then they got the blame. So we don't want that to happen, because if customer success remains just a department, you will fail. It has to be company-wide. Everyone has to be bought into it, starting at the board level, really above the CEO even, because it does require real investment to make
that's it
work.
Exactly right. I think a lot of CEOs, initially, they love to be able to just hand it off to a CS leader, right? Okay, customer success, that's your job. I think most of them realize now that they can't just hand it off. They actually have to dig in themselves.
I think Nick said this first, but the CEO has to be the chief customer success officer. If it's not that way, it just won't work.
Totally.
Yeah, this equation we use a lot, it's a little confusing, but what we're saying when we say this is customer success as a philosophy is way bigger than just customer success management.
Right, and actually on a little advertisement on Friday morning, my keynote, which is
tomorrow
apparently, is all about this idea of how do you actually make customer success embedded into every function in the company. That's what I'm seeing companies do, is say instead of the CSM team having to do everything, how do I put customer success in every other department? And that's what we'll talk about.
Yeah. So let's talk about career success, because this is really cool, especially for all of you out there who have chosen or been chosen to be in customer success. the opportunities are amazing. Customer success is truly a hot commodity. We see it. LinkedIn does this survey every single year, and this was from this year in the U.S. It's the third hottest job in Australia. I think it's the first hottest job in Europe. I don't know that there was a survey done, but I can tell you by having talked to so many of you and many others that it's obviously really, really important in Europe as well. And anybody who's tried to hire a customer success manager anytime recently knows how hard that is to do. So, and there's another aspect of this. Nick, I'll let you talk about it because you wrote this.
But. Totally, yeah. A few years ago, I said something inspired by a lot of you, which was that I think customer success is a career path that's going to take people to the C-suite. And the reason is that in the older businesses, you know, fundamentally, if you looked at the CEOs of most companies, they were either former engineers, product managers, or salespeople mostly, sometimes finance, but you know, mostly sales and engineering. And that's because the older products, businesses were all about the product and sales. But obviously in these newer businesses, in SaaS, in subscription, we all know it's about customer success, it's about the whole company working together. And frankly, the customer success team, I think in a lot of companies, knows more about how the company works than any other team, right? Like if you're in customer success, you actually know how the product works, you know the sales pitch, the marketing, the reality, you know how the support works, you know whether people pay for it or not, what the pricing is, you get the real insight. So I'm seeing customer success people actually move up, including actually our very own Allison Pickens, who's now our chief operating officer as an example inside Gainsight, move up to take on more because it's such a great starting point.
Yeah, I definitely think it's a path to the corner office. If that's the job you want, coming up through the customer organization is absolutely a new, maybe the best way to get there. So we've also started talking about this thing called prescriptive. Also driven by our customers, we didn't make this up. Our customers said, hey, you guys know this stuff, why don't you tell us how to do it? So we found that that's actually been really important. Nick, you can tell the story about what happens at every company we talk to.
100% of all customer conversations I've had start like this. Okay, let me tell you about our business. Let me tell you why we're a little bit different than other companies, right? Every company says that, right? And I think a lot of you feel that too, because you know you have differences, the type of product you sell, the model, the pricing, the if you're in a regulated industry. But in reality, we're not that different that we all need to speak totally different languages. And I think that's something we're really passionate about at Gainsight, is trying to drive more commonality.
Yeah, so sorry if we burst anyone's bubble, but you're probably not really a snowflake.
You're still special, though. All of you are special to us. Yeah.
But what we realized is that the industry of customer success needed a common language. That's what was missing. Because when we say, for example, something I'm going to talk about in a few minutes, who does it well? I get asked this question all the time. Well, I don't know what they mean by it. And even if they say who does customer success well, I don't know for sure what that means because it means so many things. So we developed this partly because Nick is a geek. You'll find out more about that tomorrow when he somehow tries to relate Einstein to customer success. But talk about our periodic table.
Totally, yeah. What we, as Dan said, we get asked all the time, what does it mean to be great in customer success? Who's doing it the best? And you know, we've met between Dan and I, the rest of the Gainsight team, with thousands and thousands of companies now. And we kind of tried to distill down the knowledge into 16 processes that we think world-class customer success teams do. Not every company does all of these, but you know, each company can kind of pick and choose. And these processes are independent of Gainsight. This is just kind of what does it mean to be world-class in customer success? Some of you have seen this before. The first four on the left are kind of those foundational ingredients to understand your customer, have a common definition of who does what. The middle is all about business processes that are well-defined to get your customers to the goals they're looking for, and also get you to your business goals, adoption, expansion, renewals, et cetera. And then finally, the right kind of bucket, the last four, are all about changing your company to be more customer-centric, changing the way you do support, the way you do professional services, how you do product development. And I think what's really cool about this, there's kind of two levels to this. Number one, hopefully this helps everyone in the industry speak a common language, like you said, and you'll see this throughout Pulse. We're gonna talk about these elements. Number two, though, I would argue that most of your businesses, if you don't already have something like this, need something like this, right? You need to standardize how your customers use your product and be prescriptive to them. So I think this is gonna become a big thing in the industry.
Yeah, it feels like that's one of the things that the SaaS model has changed, is that the expectation is that those purpose-driven applications like many of us have created come with expertise.
That's right.
And that's our expertise.
Oh, totally. We're all the vendors here. We should be the experts for our customers. We shouldn't have to make them reinvent the wheel every time.
So the last trend I want to talk about is actually customer success itself. So there's a lot of trends within customer success, but customer success as a movement is a really big deal. And we've watched this, I have now for 10 years, we've watched it very closely for the last six. One of our barometers is attendance at our Pulse events. Nick, you want to?
Yeah, I mean, when Pulse got started, you know, Dan and I were sitting in a little conference room with Anthony, our CMO, and we had no idea that it would become this. And I think at Gainsight, we've done a few things to help, but the real reason this has grown is because the community is so vibrant, the job is so big, and hopefully it feels good to be amongst so many people that are like you going through the same things. I think that's one of the biggest values people get.
Yeah, shared stories. The community really thrives on that. The other thing we use as a barometer of customer success is our book. And what we found is that over the years, the book continues to sell. And it's not just because it's a really good book, which we hope it is, we think it is, but it's because so many more people are coming into the world of customer success and they need something to refer to.
Oh my God, I mean, I will say Dan did a tremendous job. He wrote a lot of this book himself and great work, and everyone owes him a kind of a debt for putting this all together. But what's really, really cool is companies are using this across their management team. So I'm seeing a lot of companies where they make this their required reading for an offsite or a leadership event to get everyone on the same page about customer success.
Yeah, I love this quote from our editor, who basically has done dozens of business books, and he said he's never seen a business book that sold more in the second year than it did in the first year, and more in the third year than it did in the second year. And I think that's a testament to the number of people coming into the industry, not just to the book. And it's also gotten translated into Portuguese and Japanese, which, for those of you who don't know, if a publisher does that, it's not because that's cool. They do it because they want to make money. That means there's a market in Brazil and a market in Japan, so we're proud of that. So we use those two things as barometers of customer success trends. So I was going to actually talk about customer success in Europe for a little while.
All right, I'll let you take it away.
Yeah, you sure?
Yeah,
you can
awesome. Thank you, Dan. Appreciate it. I guess I'll be back on Friday.
Yeah, tomorrow. That's tomorrow.
Yeah, tomorrow.
I'll
exactly.
Send you a
thank
reminder.
You,
Nick Mehta. Nick is a little bit like a genie. If I say the word excited too many times, he'll jump back out and say, "Who's excited?" Anyway, thank you, Nick. Appreciate it. So let's talk about customer success in Europe. There's two questions that I get asked all the time, because I came over from Silicon Valley, have been here for a couple years. The first question is, what's different about customer success in the US versus Europe? The second is, who's doing it well, as I just mentioned? People ask me that all the time. Just tell me who's doing it well. I hope that you'll find out that some of the people sitting around you are actually doing it really well, and I'll talk about that in a few minutes. But let's start with what's the difference between customer success in Europe and the US? Let's get one thing really clear. The US is not one thing, and Europe is not one thing. So to say, what's the difference between these two things that are not one thing is kind of an irrelevant question. Because the reality is, customer success kind of follows the technology centers, both in Europe and the US. So customer success has been around for a long time in Silicon Valley. It's big in Austin, Texas. In Boston, of course, there's a ton of customer success people. Chicago, and then a number of other places in the US. There are pockets of technology companies. There are also places in the US that if you ask someone in any of these circles about customer success, they will look at you like you're talking Greek. They have no idea. My home state is in the middle, upper middle, North Dakota. There's not a person in that whole state who's ever heard the term customer success, except for my family, right? Who might have bought the book. I don't think they read it, but I think they might have bought it. So this is really dependent on the community that you're in, and is so driven by technology. SaaS companies put their customers on subscription. Customer success is the logical follow-on. Over some period of time, these circles, I hope, disappear. But for now, there are lots of pockets in the US that don't know anything about customer success. No different in Europe, right? If you're in London, there's a decent chance, if you're in technology, for sure, you've heard about it. Berlin has a ton of SaaS companies, so they're talking about customer success all the time. The Nordics, Amsterdam, Barcelona, Tel Aviv, et cetera, right? There's a lot of pockets where customer success matters. But then there's these places. If I go to Iceland tomorrow, part of Europe, by the way, if I go to Iceland tomorrow and say, hey, what do you guys know about customer success? They aren't going to have any idea, right? So it's not a comparison of the US and Europe. It's a comparison of those pockets, right? So it's valid for someone to say, how would you compare customer success in Berlin to Silicon Valley or something like that? So I'll share a couple of things that I think I've learned. What's the difference, and is Europe really behind in customer success? All the tech pockets get it, and they don't get it because of the book, and they don't get it because we talk about it. They get it because it's a business imperative. You have to take care of your customers. There's no choice. So necessity is the mother of invention. Everybody, whether they've ever heard of Gainsight or any other application in the world, has to solve the problem of keeping customers happy, making them renew, and buy more. So the tech pockets get it, largely because their customers are on a subscription. I do think the SaaS industry in the US is more mature. It's been around longer. There are more big SaaS companies than there are in Europe. So there's some aspects of customer success at scale and at a real level of maturity that are probably 18 months or so ahead of Europe. And as I said, large SaaS companies, a lot of large SaaS companies, if they become decent size in Europe, they actually move to the US because the market is so big. It's just a logical thing to do from a business standpoint. What I do know for sure, though, is that the gap is closing quickly, because all of you in this room are smart enough to have learned from all the mistakes that we made in Silicon Valley and back in the US. So I think that the learning curve is much more rapid in Europe, and the gap is narrowing rapidly. And I don't see, frankly, a ton of difference between how customer success is being done in the tech pockets in Europe from the US. As I said, maybe larger SaaS companies, a little bit more scale in the US, but there's not that much difference. So that's my soliloquy on what's the difference between, so don't ask me that question anymore, okay? This one, keep asking if you want to. Who's doing it well? Okay, first thing we have to do is define it. Because even if you said who's doing customer success well, I don't know how to answer that question. It depends on what you mean by it. And that's why, to go back to this, that's why we developed the elements of customer success, so we can have a common language. So when someone says to me, who's doing it well, I can say, what part of it should we talk about? Do you want to talk about renewal management? You want to talk about adoption management? You want to talk about tech touch? Which thing is it that you want to talk about? And that's what I'm going to spend a few minutes talking about now. So I'm going to stop here for a second and say this to everybody. This is not a Gainsight sales pitch. I'm going to talk about several companies doing it well. Some of them are Gainsight customers, some of them are not, and some of them are customers of our competitors. This isn't about technology. This is not, you could do it really well if only you bought our product. That's not the point. We are not here to sell you anything. We've never done that at Pulse. We're not going to start today. So with that, if you guys want to get your cameras ready, I know that a lot of you are here wanting to find somebody who's doing some piece of customer success well, because you want to talk to them. It's the biggest value of Pulse is the networking part of this. So I'm going to rattle off a few companies and what part of it they're doing well. And so if you want to know, and I put contact names on the slide as well, so if you want to know who's doing one of those things well, find them on your app, find them on email, find them because they might be sitting next to you. And if you see your company name and your logo pop up, feel free to make some noise, because I know many of you are out there. So the first one is Slido. Uh-huh, see, I told you. So Slido has a voice of the customer program that is well worth talking to them about, right? They listen to their customers, they develop that full perception of Slido from every level, and then they share that across the company. This is not a new idea, but doing it well is not all that common, and it improves their ability to impact their success and to scale their teams accordingly. This is really important, right? We all want to do this. Many of us are trying. Some of us are successful, some are not. But here's a company, if you want to find Jo Massey on the app, she's also running around helping make sure Slido works in all of our rooms really well, which is a great tool, by the way. But contact Jo, she can talk some more about that. IntelliFlow, anybody here? Yes, the answer is yes. IntelliFlow actually is going to be on this stage tomorrow morning talking about this particular story. So I won't spend a lot of time on it, but we get asked this question all the time. What is the ROI? And your CFOs and your CEOs are asking you, what value am I getting back from customer success? Should I invest more in it? Should I invest less in it? And this is a great story. IntelliFlow had a very low churn rate, and they decided if they got smart, they could reduce it even further, and they did by another 30%. So come here tomorrow morning and hear a little bit more about that. And Emily Chapman is your contact there. Thank you, Emily. Review Pro, anybody here? Yeah? Yep. In Barcelona, when I asked Neil what he thinks that they do well. He gave me a very, very long list of several things, so I just picked one of them. But they do this thing that's really important in customer success, and that is they combine what we call tech touch and human interaction in a really positive way. And here's what that means to them. They execute an email campaign to every new customer with a series of three emails. If a customer doesn't open any one of those three emails, it triggers an intervention by the customer success manager. So it's all automated until something doesn't go the way we want it to, and then it drops out and they intervene. Same thing happens if the customer does open all three of those emails, gets to the end of that process, that then also triggers an intervention by the CSM to help take the next steps. Right? This is one of the things that we're really truly all searching for. How do we combine digital and human together to make the best possible customer experience? So if you want to know more about that, find Neil or anyone at ReviewPro. It's really cool what they're doing. Signavio in the room. There they are, our friends from Berlin, monitoring customer health. We talk about this all the time. Everybody tries to do it. Some of us think that we do it pretty well. Some probably don't. But Signavio is doing this really well, monitoring customer health. And this is the reason we usually do it, so we can do early intervention. We don't want to wait till a month before the renewal to find out something's going wrong. Let's find out 9 months ahead of time, right? So watching drops in usage and escalations and customers at risk, et cetera, so you can prioritize them. That's the simplest definition of customer success. Understand your customers so you can prioritize your interactions with them. Attract in the room? Yes, they are. Okay. Executive alignment. This is really important. We do this also at Gainsight. I'll talk about that in a second. But figuring out how to get execs aligned with your customer at just the right time. Again, it comes down to monitoring customer health. In this case, Attract looks for those at-risk customers. And the minute they identify an at-risk customer, they work hard to try to set up a face-to-face or at least voice-to-voice meeting between an executive and that customer. That can help repair that relationship, can help get it back on track. That's a big deal. This is not easy stuff to do either. This is not having a list of customers and just calling them every once in a while. This is getting really smart about when to call customers and which ones I should be calling. So Jonathan is in the house, so if you want to talk some more about that, feel free to contact him. ResponseTap is a company in Manchester. They do success planning. This is kind of a high-touch activity. If you have really important customers, you're probably touching them all the time, but it'd be really valuable if you had what we call a success plan in place that really understood what their needs are and something that you could review with them. And you can see from the words here, ResponseTap does this with a unique document for every single customer, and then they do it for every existing customer as well. And then they refine this document over time, and it becomes part of the QBR process. This is really cool when you sit down and do a QBR. Here's your success plan. Here's what you said your objectives are. Here's your goals, and here's what we've accomplished. So if you want to talk about that, find Barry Cochran, and he'll talk to you about that. Last one, almost the last one, Workfront, a company in Basingstoke, if I remember right. That looks a little bit like Basingstoke, I think. Again, doesn't it? Maybe not. Maybe not the business part of Basingstoke. If anyone's ever walked down this path, please come and see me. Anyway, Workfront does, again, all of this. Notice how many of these things start with having a good health score for your customers. Creating a health score, combining both objective data as well as subjective data, because CSM sentiment has something legitimate to say about whether a customer is healthy. And then they use that score on a weekly basis in a company-wide review attended by all the key parties, right? This is kind of customer success at its core. Do we understand the health of our customers? Are we focusing on the ones who need some help with the right folks across the company, not just customer success folks? And if you can find Russ Curry, he can talk to you some more about that. The last one I'll mention really briefly, at Gainsight, we do this thing called stakeholder alignment. In fact, Easton, my CSM director, and I are going to do a session this afternoon about it. But we basically track when was the last time we touched an executive at every single customer, and if 90 days goes by, we get a triggered email to me that I can either send to that customer or call them. This is really cool. It's an automated executive sponsor program, so no customers ever fall through the cracks. I won't even give you a hint at what technology we use to do that particular thing, but you guys could figure that out. So There were a few others that were submitted to me as well. I just didn't have time to list all of them. So there's a couple of others at the bottom of this, New Voice Media and Infinity, that I didn't get to. But the point is, there are almost everybody in this room is doing some part of customer success really well. And it's worth asking them, not are you doing customer success well, but what piece of it are you doing well, and can I learn something from that? So I'll stop there. I hope you guys will find some of those folks, interact with them, learn from them. And at this time, I want to welcome to the stage my director of EMEA marketing, Ms. Lauren Ulrich.
Going for the handshake.
You had to wear your tall shoes, didn't you?
I did. Yeah. I love these.
Okay. Shoes. Well, Lauren runs marketing for Gainsight for EMEA, and we're going to talk for a few minutes about you guys, and then about the agenda. We want to make sure you're set up for success for the week. So take it away, Lauren.
So I saw a lot of familiar faces yesterday at Pulse Academy. I also met a lot of new faces. I want to thank everyone for returning this year. I know Dan mentioned that, but it really means a lot to us when you come back. And also for all of the new people here today, thank you for taking the time out of your week and away from your customers and being here with us.
Absolutely.
We have an amazing group of people in the audience representing 36 different countries, from Brazil to Morocco to Israel to Singapore, 26 European countries, and a few people from the US and Canada. We have a lot of great diversity from geographies here today. So you're probably going to pick up on a lot of different cultural differences when you're talking to attendees and doing some networking. We also have companies of all sizes represented in the room. Pulse is not just a startup event, and it's not a big company event. It's an all-company event. So you can really find people who are at a similar stage to you, or maybe at a stage that you want to be in, and talk to them about those experiences. We also have 550 unique companies in the room today, which I thought was really interesting, because at our 5,000-person event in San Francisco, we had 1,000. So you guys are really representing a lot of different companies, a lot of different stories. So great learnings that you can share when you're chatting in the Success Hall.
And you can see at the bottom some of the companies that brought a whole bunch of people. I also want to just shout out anybody who brought their whole team, even if that's only 4 or 5 people. We love this as a team event. Hallelujah. Yeah, we think this is such a great team event for CSMs, not just for this content, but you got to pull them all together once or twice a year anyway. It might as well be before or after Pulse and then do your other meetings. So really, really happy to see a bunch of people bring their teams.
That's right. So let's orient ourselves really quickly. If you were here last year, there were a lot of different floors and lifts that were being used. But we're all on one floor today. You can find the breakout rooms in the Success Hall just behind. Also, our sponsor booths and all of the catering will be in that room. And then in here, we've got some great keynotes, which Dan is going to tell us a little bit more about.
Yeah, you might have noticed we named the conference rooms after the elements as well. We probably went a little bit too far with a scientific geeky thing, but hey, it's who we are. We don't make any apologies for it. Well, sometimes. In this room, all the plenary sessions obviously are going to go on here, but also the track called Imperatives of Customer Success will take place in this room. The imperatives track is really designed for people who are getting started with customer success. It's really kind of the fundamentals of customer success. There'll be a series of sessions. There's also going to be some debates, because when you're getting customer success started, there's often some pretty healthy debates about should we pay our CSMs on a variable comp or not, things like that. So we'll have a lot of fun doing some of those things, but a lot of it will help you build the foundations of customer success.
Now, if you're one of those people who doesn't like to sit back and just listen to the presentation, and you'd rather lean in and get your hands dirty, you want to check out the Success Unplugged track. It has a roundtable format where you can really roll up your sleeves, work with other attendees through some problem solving, and it's definitely one of those things that we introduced to Pulse a few years back, and people have always loved it, so we return this track format every year.
Yeah, one of the pieces of feedback we get almost every year, this is inevitable, because we do a lot of 40-minute sessions. You can't do 4-hour sessions. People always say, can we go deeper? That topic is great, but I want to take something back. And Success Unplugged is designed specifically for that. Don't go in there to sit back and listen. Go in there with a piece of paper and a pencil, expecting to walk out with something that you can start using Monday morning back in your office. Scaling customer success. So this is another track. This track is kind of new to Pulse Europe. One of the reasons we wanted to go through the agenda is because there's things that are very different year over year. So, you know, don't be shy about coming back next year, because there'll be a lot of things that are different. And we did this in the U.S. as well. Somewhere in year three or four, you have to start actually thinking not just about small SaaS companies, but how does customer success apply to bigger companies, whether they're bigger and more mature SaaS companies or whether they're traditional software or technology companies that are doing the transformation that we talk about, this transformation around the customer. So that's what scaling customer success, the track, and all the sessions are about. And what you'll find in those sessions are people from companies that you've heard of, like Microsoft, like Autodesk, like Oracle, like Cisco, companies like that. So this is really designed for those of you who are at a certain level that are either going through that transformation or trying to figure out how to scale. Topics like how do you do customer success in a multi-product world? How do you scale global customer success across multiple regions? Things like that. So really, I reviewed every single one of these sessions personally, and the content is amazing. So if you guys are interested in any of those topics, I guarantee you that's going to be great.
And quick note about our Innovation Theater. So you can find it really close to where the sponsor booths are. As a customer success team, you probably are really familiar with a lot of other organizations that you interact with, from onboarding to professional services to support to advocacy teams. There are a lot of different technologies and solutions around customer success that really kind of enhance the CS practice at your companies. And so if you want to check out the Innovation Theater, you're going to be hearing from some of our sponsors, and they're really showcasing the best practices that align what they're doing to customer success. It's really very, very valuable.
Yep. So Gainsight Unplugged, I told you that you won't hear any sales pitch from here. You won't hear any sales pitch anywhere except in our booth. But we do get asked by lots of companies, lots of people, to tell them how we do customer success and how we use Gainsight. So we do have a series of sessions that are specifically that. So if you go to a Gainsight Unplugged session, please do not put any feedback saying you shouldn't have been talking about Gainsight. That's what that one's for, and you don't have to go there. But if you want to know how we do it and how we use Gainsight, this is really, really relevant. And even if you're not a Gainsight customer, which I know most of you are not, that might be really relevant, because you got to figure out how to do some of these things anyway, whether it's in a tool like Gainsight or another tool, or if you have to use Excel. But you got to figure out how to do these things anyway. So this is really relevant, even if you don't have a technology to do it with, or if you're thinking about it and you want to help formulate some ideas on what your technology should or could do for you, this would be a really good session. But mostly it's just practical. Like, how do we do stakeholder alignment? What does that actually look like in the system?
Exactly. And in that same vein, if you want to see examples of how customer success organizations are using Gainsight to better their practices around customer success, you can check out the stories that we have in the Success Showcase. These are some companies that are doing really amazing things with Gainsight, but also just like as a department. And so we have a lot of details on the agenda that you can find about these specific stories here.
Yeah. Has anyone ever done anything in a conference room called Xenon before? I haven't. This will be the first. Okay, keep going, Lauren.
Okay, so you will also notice that in four of our breakout rooms, we have headsets. This will help us with a couple of things. It'll help us with the noise levels. They're pretty comfy. I tried some on myself. They're very easy to operate. And just one comment about them. You can't take them from room to room. They should stay in the room that they're in. Otherwise, you'll be hearing somebody else, and you'll be like, what's happening? So hopefully that helps with the noise. We have had an open concept conference before, and that was one of the pieces of feedback, so we decided to implement this to make sure we were covered.
Yeah, this space is great because we can do almost anything we want with it, but it does end up being noisy. So embrace technology. Put your headsets on. Please don't complain about it. I think it's going to be really great. We've been to a couple conferences where they do that. It's like, hey, that's a good idea. Let's do that ourselves.
So we also want to take a second to recognize all of the Pulse Academy graduates from yesterday.
Stand up.
If you were there yesterday, please stand up. We want to do a round of applause.
Yes. Yeah, for all of those people, Pulse started yesterday, where we do what we call Pulse Academy, which is essentially training. Kind of a novice and an advanced training for customer success managers, and then another one for admins. And it was great. The energy is awesome. I'm so happy when I see young people who can keep energy for three full days. I'm not sure if that's going to be me tomorrow afternoon or not, but check back with me then. We'll find out. But thank you all for coming. We had a great time sharing some of what we know about customer success with all of you, and I hope it was good.
I also want to take a moment to recognize some of our Gainsight Gives participants. So Gainsight Gives is a program that we started a few months ago, which basically helps people who are looking to re-enter the workforce get an idea about customer success, what does it all entail, what does the profession look like. And so we put it out there on social media and through a couple of local organizations to try to find people who, you know, thought that this would be an interesting potential new career path. And so we had a few people join us yesterday, and they're also here at the conference. So thank you to them for applying and attending. And then next year we're going to repeat this. So if you can think of people who might be interested, the program's called Gainsight Gives.
Yeah, this is a program I'm super proud of. It's just so great to have a chance to be doing something that we can invite people into. And those coming back into the workforce, that's a hard thing, whether you're a working mom or taking care of your parents or a veteran or anything like that. We want to embrace that community because we think customer success can be a great entry-level job, or in many cases, it's not entry-level because these people have wonderful experience. They just need a pathway back in. So I'm really proud of Gainsight as a company that we're doing something like that. And truly, I'm going to echo what Lauren said. If you know people like that, let's get them a free pass for Pulse next year because we want them to embrace this particular community.
We just wanted to pause for a second and thank our wonderful sponsors for helping make this event possible. If you were here last year, you may have seen we didn't really have a lot of sponsors. So this year, we're really excited to have everyone on board, and there's been a lot of excitement with our partner community, so thank you to them.
Yeah, you can't do a great conference without great sponsors. I know we wish the world didn't necessarily operate commercially, but it does, and our sponsors are truly great. So make sure you stop by their booths, look for those QR codes wherever
QR
they might
code.
Be.
Yeah, just about to mention the QR code. Just quickly, so we have a very packed agenda, and we're packing even more in at lunch. So on Thursday today, if you go to the Cobalt Room with the round tables, you can find Circles of Success, which is a really cool format where there are a bunch of different topics. You probably saw it in your emails, where people express interest, and we're going to have people there taking notes and kind of guiding the discussion. So you can bring your lunch into that room. And then on Friday, if there are any Gainsight customers in the audience, please join us in that same Cobalt Room. We're going to be talking a little bit about the product, and we're going to be giving away those coveted Sally Awards. Now, okay, I have 5 updates. I'm going to blow through them in 2 minutes and 39 seconds.
That's right.
So first one is we've introduced a thing called Career Corner, which you can find between Helium and Cobalt in that back corner. You can get your LinkedIn headshot refreshed. So, you know, freshen up.
Yep, comb your hair.
Yep. And we're also going to have some of our seasoned customer success team members staffed back there. So if you have questions about the career of customer success, they can help give some advice. Second thing, we do have QR codes kind of hidden all over. And if you look at your mobile app, there's a section called QR Code Hunt. There are 3 ways that you can find these codes. The first is we have our elements hidden around. There are going to be clues as to where you can find them. It's kind of like an Easter egg hunt. Number 2, you can visit our sponsors, and they'll explain exactly how you can get a picture of their QR code. And then 3, there are a handful of Gainsight employees here who have QR codes on the back of their badge. Every 3 that you find, you can then go to the Gainsight booth and get a raffle ticket. And the raffle tickets are good for a chance to win tickets to the England versus USA game happening at Wembley, or the England versus Croatia game also happening at Wembley. Wembley is one of our sponsors, and they have graciously decided to share these tickets with us. There are a couple of other ways that you can earn these prizes, but I don't want to spoil them. So elements of surprise, make sure you stick around where we give those away at the end. Okay, number 4. We have Professor Brian Cox in the house.
Woo.
Applause, applause.
I know. It's going to be
so
great.
I'm so excited. Yeah, he will be our Friday closing keynote. You may recognize him from various programs on the BBC. Maybe you've read his books. But he's going to be absolutely amazing. We did a prep call with him, and we were starstruck.
It's going to be awesome.
Pun intended. Stars, universe, galaxy. So yeah, it'll be great. Make sure you stick around
Friday afternoon.
corny jokes. Okay, and then the 5th update is the Pulse Europe Big Bang Bash. It kicks off tonight at 6:15 at Pergola Olympia, which is just around the corner on the fifth floor of the car park. Since we end a little bit before 6:15, I recommend you just go to a pub, grab a pint, and then we'll have doors open at 6:15. All you need is your badge. Final 11 seconds. Make sure you download the Pulse Conference app. If you're going to tweet, use our hashtag. We will have slides available at the end of every day. This is the bit.ly link. We'll be sharing that all around. Coffee 24/7. In the Success Hall. Scan those QR codes to collect your raffle tickets. If you have questions, registration booth is the place to be, or you can email pulseeurope@gainside.com. And now, if you will all join me in taking out your phones, we're going to test the Slido functionality. Slido is a really amazing application that is in either the mobile app under the menu, or you can go to slido.com. If it asks you to enter a room code, enter Pulse Europe. And now, this is something that we're going to have in every breakout room. So if there's Q&A, you can go to the Slido app and type in questions. They can either be anonymous or named. You can upvote other people's questions. And there's also a really cool polling feature. So in the spirit of science, if you can just share your favorite science subject. I don't know, Dan, what's yours?
I flunked physics. So I'd go with chemistry.
I would go with chemistry, too. All right. I really like that one.
Okay.
Especially it fits in with our elements theme. All right. So now that you all know how to use Slido, make sure that you're asking questions in the breakouts and in all the different sessions, because that's what makes it great and interactive. And thank you all for being here.
Okay. Thanks, Lauren.
Yeah, thank you.
All right. So most of you know the world we live in changes a lot, right? Customer success specifically. And so Gainsight specifically made a significant change a couple weeks ago when we acquired a company. And I want Nick and then one of our new employees from a company called Aptrinsic to come on for a few minutes and talk about the meaningfulness of this idea of customer success and product coming together. So I think if I say excited three times, Nick will appear. Let's do it together. Excited, excited, excited. There he is. I knew it would happen.
How's it going, man?
Really good.
Great job.
Thanks for doing this.
Thank you. Dan talked about a genie in the lamp, I think, making me appear. When I talk to customer success leaders about what if you had a genie, what if you had your three wishes, what would you want? Now, most people would say they'd want a raise and they'd want a sabbatical. But after those two things, the top thing I hear over and over again from customer success leaders is they want to work better together with their product organization. They see a huge opportunity for CS and product to work together and for them to collaborate to serve clients better. Raise your hand if you feel like you can work better with your product organization you'd like to, right? And you can see it across the room. What we hear specifically is three things. Most companies want to do a better job getting data out of the product to really understand what's happening with that user behavior in your product. Number two, they want to do a better job scaling through the product. The product is in front of that customer every day, and how can we make the product scale the customer success and customer experience? And number three, most of our customer success kind of friends in the community have all this insight on what could be in the product. They want to learn how to influence the product roadmap. So those three things, data, scale, and influence, are three things that actually happened already in a different industry. Sales and marketing used to be totally separate, and now they work together in most companies around data, around scale, and around influence. And we bought this company, Aptrinsic, with the idea of bringing together product and customer success. And I'm really excited to welcome Travis Kaufman, VP of Marketing for Aptrinsic at Gainsight. Welcome, Travis. Awesome, man. All right, I'll let you take it away. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Nick. Hi, everyone. How are you? I'm good, too. Thank you. So I wanted to share a little color into why this topic is so interesting to me. So throughout my career, I've been in product, and I've built product for marketing and sales leaders historically. And as a product leader, I also know what it's like to work with a tremendously top-notch customer success organization. And when product and success are working well together, the types of outcomes that we can deliver. And so it may not always feel this way, but customer success as a team has such an important role and a tremendous amount of influence within the organization. And one of the trends here that is influencing this is how we deliver our products to market through the subscription SaaS businesses. And so historically, if a company wanted to grow, you would be introducing new funds into your marketing and sales organizations, and you would be acquiring new customers. That's your vehicle for growth. And in this view, the customer actually does not have a lot of power. They have negotiating power before the deal's done, and once the deal closes, they're stuck, right? So you have to go buy a new solution to switch. So in the age of the customer, and this is the trend that has brought so much power shift from marketing and sales organizations to the customer success organizations, is this focus on customer lifetime value. So in this SaaS-based model, where the customer is paying over time, they have just as much control, if not more, than the organization itself. This puts you, as the steward of the customer, in a very powerful position, as you are now have more than just keeping revenue, you have the ability to grow it. So you hear us talk a lot at Gainsight about the customer success and how it is a combination of exceptional experiences plus desired outcomes. And now if we were to drill into that exceptional experience, I know that there's a portion of this that is feels out of your control, and knowing that you have responsibility to make your customers successful, it puts you in a very difficult position. So the two primary influences here are the product experience, as you heard Nick mention earlier, as well as the experience that the customer has with every aspect of your organization, from support to services to the account management. And it's this area that, when combined with product, is transformational for an organization. And so let me paint a very familiar picture for you. You have a lot of accounts to manage. You have large accounts that require a lot of resources to make successful. You have small accounts, but you have many of them that represent a good portion of revenue for your business. And then you have every level in between. And so what you end up doing is, you know, you take your best success team and you apply them to your highest value customers, and then you take that model and you try to bring it down into the smaller, higher volume businesses, and ultimately there's a breaking point to where you can't hire or you can't afford to spend more money to support these customers this way. And what Nick mentioned earlier is that what you ended up here with is a set of customers that you say, well, they bought from us, and unfortunately, we can't support them effectively in a cost-effective manner, so good luck to you. We've got some great documentation, good luck. Now, the challenge for all of us is how can we deliver to all of our customers that exceptional experience, both through the product as well as all the engagements that we have. And what we're really asking for is a secret weapon. So what if we had a secret weapon that allowed us to deliver that same customer experience from our highest value customers all the way through to the smallest of accounts? And the truth of the matter is that we do have it available to us today, but it hasn't been accessible. And that secret weapon is your product. Now, one of the challenges here is that when you look at how products were delivered in the past, they were very disconnected. So you would treat it like you would sell any good. You would deliver this to your customer, you would have no visibility into if they used it or not, if they were happy with it, and you had no ability to course correct based upon that information. So in the age of the customer, what we're now able to do is use our product as a conduit into our customers. We have great insights that are available now, and we can use that information to make very intelligent decisions around how we interact with our customers. The second thing that we can do now is we can respond both through a technology touch as well as an in-person touch to give them that best experience possible. So things like presenting a dialogue to your customers when they log in for the first time, or when they log in for the fifth time, or perhaps guide them to a new set of capabilities. You can even, at the point they complete using a feature, you can now listen and ask for feedback that is very explicit around how was your use of this feature, providing you a scalable way to collect that feedback. Historically, if you wanted to do any of these items, you would have to go to your product would go to their engineering team, and they would have to spend months on, and if not quarters, to implement and build this themselves. That's the big change that's happened here, is that you now have the technology in your hands to do this without having to build it in-house, having to build it yourself. So when you have access to this technology this way, and you don't have to wait for these long cycles, how does that change your customer engagement strategy? You now have a model that looks something like this, to where you have very high-value customers, and you want to deploy very high a very high-touch human engagements to make sure they're successful. Maybe that organization needs some transformational change within the organization. You can take the information that you have from your product to inform that transformation as well. So again, there's a place for the technology touch in addition to the human touch, even those high-value accounts. And as you move down into your higher-scaled accounts, where you have many, many customers, you can now introduce a very personalized product experience that only when needed would incorporate a human enhancement. So really what we're able to do now with the technology is respond to our customers through multiple vehicles that are most relevant for them in a way that we can support through our own business. So let me step over to how this relates to sales and marketing. Sales and marketing now have joined forces, but there has always been a massive tension between the marketing departments and the sales departments. Marketing would spend a massive amount of money. They would acquire new leads for the organization. They would hand them over to the sales organization. And the sales team wouldn't call them. Very frustrating for the marketer, who's now on the hook for justifying why they spent so much money. And the sales organization responds with, well, they're not very good. The leads weren't good. And this creates a massive tension. That is a very familiar tension as a product leader. And having worked with many successors in the past, there is also an equal amount of tension that is similar. One of the biggest changes that influenced marketing and sales collaboration is the fact that technology brought them both together. So marketers now had solutions to identify who were the good quality leads before they bring it to the sales organization, and sales had tools to hand leads back to the marketing organization to continue to nurture. So again, the same shift that happened that brought these two teams together brought tremendous efficiencies to how they work. The same needs to happen with product and success. And if you look at these three items here, some of the things that we can do together between product and success is the ability to scale onboarding and continue that onboarding journey through your product. You know, you have kickoff calls, you have meetings where you're talking to a very select few users of the product. And then you have now an extension to every user that joins or that logs into your application. You can now provide them with their own set of onboarding tasks. And again, giving you that power to reach all of the users without having to spend countless hours on the phone. The second, driving new opportunities based on usage data. You know, being able to identify when customers go above a given usage threshold, you can trigger the follow-ups with them for upsell opportunities. Or you can identify the features that correlate with an upsell opportunity. And you can use this information and act on it accordingly and drive new opportunities for your business. And the third item is influencing the product roadmap. You have a tremendous amount of information and a very deep level with the accounts that you interact with. Product teams are operating on a breadth. They're looking at trend data, they're looking at market data, and the combination of the two is what's really going to drive an effective product strategy and a product roadmap. So again, you have a strong voice into this discussion, and bringing the right set of data when you work with your product teams will make all the difference. So what I'd like to leave you with today really is a call to arms. Really, the age of the customer is yours for the taking. You know, there is no better team, there's no better function within the organization to be the champion of growth than customer success. The second item is to partner with your product team. They need you as much as you need them, and to combined create that exceptional product experience that will help the customer deliver and achieve the business outcomes that they want from your product and achieve that great customer success outcome. And the last item here is establish a growth mindset. What's working today may not always work. Look at the information you have available to you. Start to make small changes and make incremental improvements to both process, and how you interact with your customers. So with that, I'd like to thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Pulse Europe 2018 will continue after a 15-minute break.